Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Ebenezer. We're glad you're here this morning. I'm Nick, one of the pastors here. Thanks for joining us. I'd like to personally welcome you to our fellowship. If you're not new with us, please catch me afterward. I'll be kind of walking around. I'd love to talk with you. And if we haven't met and you've been here the whole while, come and see me. I want to talk. Encouragement, stick with your Bible reading. If you're reading through the scripture with us, stay at it. It's easy to kind of get tired, but keep after it. It'd be good. I want to encourage you, if you're not engaged, there's a lot of Sunday school classes at the 9 o'clock hour. Please feel free to jump right in. I think you'll enjoy those, and I know that we could use you. Now, next week, there's going to be a lunch here following service, and I don't know if it's, I think it should be in the bulletin. Read the bulletin, but I think it's a chili and cobbler, if that's not, if that correct. I think chili and cobbler. Pie is a lot like cobbler, so, you know, if it's, I like pie, so. Out there in the lobby, there's a little sign up. We'd like a little extra help with setup, cleanup, and some serving. So if you'd sign up out there, that'd be nice, so we can help with that as well. Also a note that we're going to be having baptism and new member service on October 16th. So if you'd like to be involved in that, like to be baptized, or like to become a member of Ebenezer, please connect with the office or myself. Also, there's just a brief update. Last evening, a thing went out on a prayer request for Eleanor Burkholder. Was thought to be having a heart attack. The symptoms, it was not a heart attack. Their symptoms kind of mimicked that. She was in the ICU at Blanchard as of last night, feeling very much improved. So it was good news that she's feeling considerably better. Before we pray, I don't know if Pastor Dick is here somewhere. Where is he? There he is, part of the Nick, Glick, and Dick crew here. Pastor Dick Potter is turning 80 today, so doesn't look a day over 60, and so we're glad to have him. Happy birthday, Dick.
Good morning, Ebenezer family. Would you bow and pray with me this morning? Father God, we come to you this morning just on this beautiful morning that you've given to us, Lord. This is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, Lord. We're so thankful that we're able to meet here as a church body in freedom, that we can join here together to worship, to learn of your word. Lord, we pray today for those who are struggling, that aren't able to be here because of physical ailments or emotional issues, or Lord, even those that are struggling spiritually to come back, Lord, we pray for them today. Pray that your healing touch would be upon their mind, soul, and body, Lord. We thank you for just healing people. There's just so much anxiety and depression going on, Lord, and amongst our midst. We just come against that, Lord. We pray that your peace would come to these people who are struggling, Lord. We also lift up our pastors to you today, Pastor Nick, Pastor David, and Pastor Dick, Lord. We pray that you would be with them and their families, Lord, and protect them as our enemy, the devil, does not like what's going on here at Ebenezer. Lord, that people's lives are being reached here through the week and on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night program, Lord. Just pray that you'd be with them, their family, their kids, that you would just have safety upon them, Lord. Also pray for the church staff, our committees, our children's church teachers, Lord. Pray for all of them that are serving, God. We're just so thankful that we have a church here of people that are so willing to serve and for the cause of Christ. And we just pray that you would be with them as well. Keep them safe, Lord, and I just pray for their families as well. Lift them up, and Lord, we're just so thankful for them today as well. Pray for our missionaries, both here locally and around the world. Lord, I pray for just that the gospel would go forth. I pray that funds would be available, made available to them. Especially want to lift up Josh Hanna today, Lord, as he is taking a flight to Poland and a train over to Ukraine, and he's serving over there. Lord, I just pray that you would be with him, bring him back to us as he's going to be serving over there for the next month. I just pray for safety with him. I pray for peace for Crystal and Wyatt and Eloy is gone, Lord. Help them to know that you have Josh in your hands right where you want him to be and that he is fulfilling what he feels that you've called him to do, Lord, as he serves in Ukraine. Lord, I pray for us today as we worship, that our worship would be in spirit and truth to you today, and that our worship would be honoring to you, and that would open our hearts to receive the word that Nick's going to bring us today, Lord. I pray that that word would get into our lives and would change us, Lord. Help us to be doers of the word and not hearers only. We thank you for all these things and what you're going to do in our midst today, and as we take what we learned this week and apply it to our lives, what you're going to do this week in our jobs and in our schools. In your precious name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
We'd like to invite those from the mission team to Alaska to come on up, and they're going to share a little bit about their trip. And then following, Tim Gallant's going to talk about Kids Hope USA. So come on up. We want to hear, there we are. We want to hear about the Alaska trip.
I'm Ron Meyer. There's some of us missing. There was eight that was on this trip. So I want to, like you said about Josh, he was supposed to be our spokesman, but I had to arm wrestle all these guys so I could get to talk. So, yeah, Josh, he's with the Samaritan's Purse in Ukraine. So this Echo Ranch that we went to is a little different than most of you are thinking about. It's about 100 miles north of Juneau. The camp was given to them by a Presbyterian church because they could no longer afford to staff and maintain it. It's a very beautiful site, and it's set up with three cabins with beds only, 16 in each cabin. There was a room, and there'll be rooms in the future above the maintenance building for work teams. There were two missionaries there, Daniel with his wife and five children from Florida, and Austin, who's single, from Kansas. They're very committed and skilled, and the food is awesome. It was a service trip, wasn't a mission trip, but we got fed way too good. Our job was to get the camp ready for winter since we was the last work team for the year. It's not a year-round camp. Water needs to be drained and electric turned off, I believe, at the end of October. We started our day with devotions that was led by someone different every day. We put in windows, hung siding, and soffit to an addition that will have a new kitchen, laundry, and pantry, a sewer system, and did drywall and painting and maintenance in the maintenance building and another small building. Supplies came from Seattle, so you didn't just run to Vetter's or Lowe's in case you miscalculated or damaged something. Overall, we accomplished our needs through their skills and organization and our work. Next year's plan is for a new bath, shower, and a demolition of the old bath and shower rooms. So there's future need for people and dollars. We believe the staff is being wise with winning people to know Jesus and using your donation dollars wisely. So I thank you for your support. And I also want to thank Crystal for helping get us home, because we missed the first flight because the wind, it was too windy. So she had to do a bunch of reorganizing. So the first one was messed up, it's all messed up. But so thank you. Kurt's going to talk now.
Thanks, Ron. Yeah, my name is Kurt Meyer, but you feel free to call me by any name you wish. These guys decided my name is Chris for the week. That was thanks to Steve. I really wish Steve was here this morning, because I learned a lot from Steve. We played a lot of cards in our free time. And he taught me that, some of the tricks that he goes by. And I think he goes on, if you aren't cheating, you aren't trying. You got to really hold your cards back when you're playing with them. But no, it was a lot of fun. I had a great time, especially with these guys. But I like to share some about our experience, and especially my side with being relatively new to the service trips. I had my eyes opened at Echo Ranch. Just an amazing place. I think several of you have been there or know about it, and I understand why you support the camp. It was a few days after being there that I got a sense for the camp, where everything is at, and kind of realized that there is no project too big for this place. You know, you think about the location and the terrain and the challenges, the mountains, the glaciers, the water, and, you know, just getting everything, all the supplies and materials up there. It's a real challenge, and I just think it speaks to the growing faith that is going on up there, you know, that anything can be done, and that God will bring the right people at the right time to make those activities happen. And that includes the missionaries and the people already serving at the camp. I have a good friend, Parker, that has been serving up there for several years. And so I've kind of heard a lot about, you know, what's going on and his side, but it was great to actually walk in his path for a week and see what they go through and what they see. And, you know, it's great that they have answered their call to serve. You know, they give up many comforts to go live that life. And Parker told me that there was a sriracha shortage this year, and he could not find any in Juneau. And he, I guess, is a big sriracha guy. But they also do a lot more than the role that they are, you know, that they are given. You know, there's anything from making food, cleaning, maintenance, all the above. They go way beyond just their service role. And this hit me too when me and Ron walked into the kitchen about 9 or 10 one night, and Parker was in there baking cookies. And I know they were good because I had 3 or 4. Josh, I think, had at least 12. but yeah, that was some of my experience, and I just want to say thank you to Josh and Crystal for organizing, managing the trip. It was great what you did for us. Thank you to the guys standing on the stage and the ones that aren't here to allow me to work with them for a week. And thank you, all of you out there, for your prayers and support for Echo Ranch. It is an amazing place. God's hand is all over that camp. I guess I'd encourage anyone that doesn't know about it or hasn't been there to take a time to learn more about it. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Tim. I'm one of the newest additions to the staff here, and I'm so happy to be with you this morning. It was October of 2000, and I was in college up in Defiance, and it was when I first met John. I was doing some volunteer work at a local elementary, and by a mutual contact, his parents contacted me and said John was struggling in his relationships with his teachers, his peers, his parents. He was just struggling in all kinds of areas, and he needed just some extra time, some extra person to come with him and spend time with him. So we first met to his house and got acquainted with him, and it was a little bit of a struggle at first, but my goal became, how can I make this little third grader smile? And it took a bit to get that trust developed between us, but after a while, I would pick him up after school, and he would say something like, I have the perfect thing that we can do today. Or when I drop him off, he would say something like, what day are we going to get to meet together again? And the last time we got to see each other, after I was getting ready to complete university, I was back in his backyard, and we were just being goofy together, telling jokes, and I could just see him smiling, that smile that I always wanted him to smile. There are children like John at our local elementary school here in Bluffton who could use that same kind of unconditional love and attention. They may be experiencing such things as, you know, a divorce in their family, a parent who is sick, having struggles with their peers or in their classes, and they just need a little more time. And there's a variety of situations like that. The reason that they're going through these things doesn't matter. The child does matter. So each child is referred by a parent or a teacher to someone who has a great potential, who could use a little extra one-on-one attention in order to blossom and grow. And that's why I'm sharing with you today. Everybody do something for me. Everybody want to hold up one finger like this. Can anybody do that? Now, we're not going to sing This Little Light of Mine. We're not going to do that, okay? I know someone maybe wanted to. But this is how the program works. One mentor, one student, 1 hour a week. That's it. You can put your hands down. It's a simple program, one student, one mentor, 1 hour a week, and that's all it takes. Our school here in Bluffton is asking for mentors, people who are willing to walk alongside a child, to play, to read, to do a craft, to be that loving influence to them one time a week. It's really simple. Just be a friend to a kid. So the time commitment is just 1 hour, and you'll be trained and well-supported within the congregation. So please let me know of your interest. There's a table in the back for a sign-up sheet. You can talk to me throughout the week. We can go through the training. Bluffton Elementary and Mr. Till are asking for the start out 10 to 15 mentors. That's how many kids they have. And I believe our church can meet that need through mentors. So talk to me or talk to one of the other church staff after church. And thank you very much for your investment in the community in Bluffton Elementary. Thank you.
All right, congregation, thank you as we have listened today, and God is moving. God is moving in our midst. We're going to stand and sing How Great Thou Art and The Old Rugged Cross. And the core, I know that the majority of us, all of us, know the chorus to How Great Thou Art, but I think it bears worth repeating. Then sings my soul, not then sings my voice, not then sings anything, but then sings my soul, and that's where the Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit comes out of us as we share our love with those, including these folks at Bluffton Elementary School, up in Alaska, wherever we may be. Say hello to our neighbors. Let's worship the Lord together this morning. My God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my
shall come. With shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And sings, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. How great is our God. Let's sing of the old rugged cross.
Suffered and died to God and sanctify me. exchange it someday for a crown.
Amen. Please be seated. We're in Jeremiah this morning, Jeremiah 23, and before we get there, let me pray once more. Father, I pray that you would teach us this morning what we need to know and that you would transform us into what we should be, all for your glory, Lord. Pray for your nearness to us. Give us wisdom and insight to your text, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Jeremiah chapter 23. Is a tough chapter, actually. It's a tough chapter because, again, the prophet is being rather direct. He's being rather direct this time to a different group of people. Before, we've talked about as he goes and talks to all the people, he go into the temple and set up and talk to all the people, or go out into the city and tell the people, or go around the country and tell the people. In this case here, he's going to be speaking very specifically to the leaders and to the priests and the prophets. So notice that that's going to be a little bit different today. But as I was preparing today, for today, one of the things that reminded me of, because there's a resounding theme that he's threaded through this passage, reminded me of back in the days, I grew up on a farm. I know that's hard to believe. We had a large pig farm, and it was kind of a corporate thing. And I just remember growing up, from as little as I can remember, would be out in the barns working that. And at a certain point in my life, when as I grew in my capacity and I grew in my competence on the farm, I would head out and I would go into, there was an office in the farm. It was kind of interesting, in the barn. So I'd go out into to the office of the pig barn, and my dad would have taken a piece of paper, and he would have written a rather extensive list of items that were critical for that day's work. And we wouldn't even have to talk. He would just put the list out there. I would grab the list. I would review it. I would talk to some of the other employees. And then we would split out. And our job for the day was to attempt to accomplish the list. Not always easy, usually smelled bad, usually required a lot of hard labor. But I grew accustomed to that, and I look back in these days with affection to that, because it was like, hey, he trusted me enough to put it out in front of me and know that even as a teenager, I'd go out and follow my father's instructions. And there were days that maybe didn't feel quite like it, but he still trusted me with that. As we get into Jeremiah chapter 23, we're going to see that God had entrusted people with his word. God had entrusted people of authority with his word and with his instructions. And they failed. They failed to take, if you will, the list seriously. They failed to take the responsibility of those who were counting on them to take the word and put it to work. And the consequence is profound. The consequence is profound. Allow me to begin reading chapter 23, verse 1 through the English Standard Version. It says, "Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who care for my people. You have scattered my flock and driven them away, and you have not attended to them. Behold, I will attend to you for your evil deeds, declares the Lord. And then I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them. I will bring them back to the fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will set shepherds over them who care for them, and they shall fear no more, nor me dismayed, neither shall any be missing, declares the Lord." Quite interesting here. He's separating. When he says shepherds, he's talking about the governance of the kings and those who would govern under the kings. He's not talking about the religious leaders. And I find it quite interesting, the responsibility that God had placed on the leaders from a perspective of God's stuff, God's word, God's instructions. That God didn't expect them just to be kings or governors or whatever leaders, but they expected them to be representatives of God. He's holding them accountable for how they responded to the word of God. The kings were responsible for the people, not just to keep them safe, not just to keep, you know, the borders secure, but to direct them back to why they did what they would do, what justice was like in the country. And that justice was driven by the word of God. The kings were instructed to write the scriptures in their own hand as a copy, so they had it, so they knew it, so they were, if you will, infused with the instructions of God. Because as soon as the king got off, the people would see, well, if he can do that, well, I can do that. And I thought, wow, that is really interesting. They're responsible for the spiritual well-being, even though that wasn't necessarily their job to teach or preach. They were responsible for leading and living well. And I thought, wow, how true to life in our world today. Parents, leaders in the church, leaders in the workplace, what's your responsibility? Do you know the word of God? Have you given the list? When you get to the workplace, what are you living by? What are you working by? What is the nature of the people that are watching you looking to? And I, that's really profound that he's not letting them off the hook. He's going to turn real quick here and go after the priests and the prophets. They're going to get the biggest stick today. But the leaders don't get off the hook on that. And he's saying, not only when, you know, as you've missed the point here, I'm going to gather them back and I'm going to give them real leaders. I'm going to give them leaders and listen to the nature of what the leader is going to be like. Verse 5 says, behold, the days are coming. Now, you should underline, behold, the days are coming. Because in verse 7, he's going to say, therefore, behold, the days are coming. He's pointing to a time future when things are going to be very different. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely and execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved. Israel will dwell securely, and this is the name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. Oh, the governance of this branch is going to be driven by righteousness, not economic well-being, not all the stuff that everybody wants. You know, it's about the economy, right? Listen to our politicians someday. What are they saying? If you vote for me, it's going to be, everything's going to be great, right? It's going to be good. The question is, can anything be good without righteousness? No, it can't. It's not designed like that. Righteousness, justice, the things that really matter are at the heart of it. And he's talking about this, the Lord is our righteousness. It's interesting that he uses the analogy, he will raise up for David a righteous branch. Isaiah talked about that back, you know, a long time before. In chapter 11 of Isaiah, he says, then a shoot will spring up from the stem of Jesse. A branch from his roots will bear fruit, and the Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him, and the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, a Spirit of counsel and strength, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, and he will delight in fear of the Lord. And it goes on to talk about our Jesus. That Jesus would be the branch. He would become the king, that he will rule in a way that is driven by righteousness. Additionally, verse 7, therefore, behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when they shall no longer say, as the Lord lives, who brought up the people of Israel out of the land of Egypt. But they're going to say this, as the Lord lives, who brought up and led the offspring of the house of Israel out of the north country and out of all the countries where he had driven them. Then they shall dwell in their own land. He's saying, you know how great it was when God sent Moses? God sent Moses to get a nation out of Egypt. And we have the plagues and the Red Sea and the wandering and all of it. You know, and that was kind of the anchor for all this history. This is our God, the God who will deliver us from captivity. He said, you know what? As great as that was, that's not what you're going to talk about in the future. There's going to be a second Exodus. It's going to be greater than the first Exodus. When God takes his scattered people and he goes gets them from the four corners of the earth, he's going to gather his people and none of them are going to be missing. Talks about it in the Revelation. It talks about it in Deuteronomy. It talks about it from beginning to end, how God is going to deliver his people that have been scattered. And he'll bring them back into the land. Remember the covenants? The land, the seed, and the blessing? They just keep popping up, don't they? He's going to deliver them back. And it's going to happen in a time when Jesus is coming back. But now he takes a pivot. And the pivot is now going to the prophets. Concerning the prophets, verse 9. These prophets, to make it very simply, is they're just making up stuff. Okay? They're just pulling it out of their head and saying stuff. And it's creating a massive issue among the people. This is what he says. This is, if you will, an excerpt from Jeremiah. Concerning the prophet, he says, my heart is broken within me. All of my bones shake. I'm like a drunken man, like a man overcome by wine because of the Lord and because of his holy words. He was so taken by the word and the words of God and who God was that he was trembling. That he was shaken, if you will, to the core. Not only did he see what the word of the Lord had said, but he's now looking at the nation around him. And if what the scripture says was true and the people are doing what they're doing, what is God required to do? What is God going to do in light of what he's stated? And as I was thinking about that, I don't know about you guys, this is one of my favorites. One of my favorite passages, and if you have a Bible, you can turn with me because this should be highlighted, underlined, and starred in your Bible. In Isaiah 66, it talks about it, and it's really what it amounts to is this. Through the Word of God, God has, if you will, given the list for his children on how to live. He's given the list, and it was out of an act of graciousness. And in Isaiah chapter 66, God talks about the posture or the attitude toward what he has given will really be the measure of how he looks at his children. And this is from the New American Standard. I'm going to switch this up. I apologize for that. But in verse 1 of chapter 66 says this, thus says the Lord, heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool. Where then is a house you could build for me? And where is the place that I might rest? For all my hands had made all these things. Thus all these things came into being, declares to the Lord. So he's saying, you're going to build a house? You think you can constrain me into this little place in Jerusalem? That's where you think I exist? I made everything. What are you going to do for me that's of substance? I'm the creator of everything. But he says this, but to this one I will look. What he's saying is, if you want to get the attention of the God of the universe from the heavens, the personal God, this is who he looks to him who is humble and contrite of spirit, who trembles at my word. That's it. Take the list, take the word, treat it with the respect that is intended, like the prophet. He looked at the word and he's trembling. If this is true, we're going to get it in the shins. Because we've been that bad. I looked at the list and I believe it. And it's terrifying. It's terrifying. His bones are shaking. He says, I'm overcome because of the Lord and his holy words. True fear of the Lord and the unfailing truth of his words. I'm reading a book like right now, and I think it's pertinent to this. And the book is called When People Are Big and God Is Small. I'm like, yeah, that's kind of the world we live in, isn't it? We fear people writing nasty stuff about us online or something like that. And we don't fear the God of the universe. We don't fear his word. We don't take it with the seriousness that it requires. Why is he shaking? Because of the Lord and his holy words. For, that's a connector there. It's important to see the connection. Why is he trembling? He knows what the word says. For the land is filled with or full of adulterers, because the curse of the land, because of the curse, the land mourns, and the pastures of the wilderness are dried up. Their course is evil, and their might is not right. He's just referring back to Deuteronomy chapter 28. That's all he's talking about. Deuteronomy chapter 28, back when God made the promise, he says, but when it comes about, if you don't obey the Lord your God to observe all his commandments, his statutes, I charge you today, and all these curses will come upon you and overtake you. I'm going to give you the list. If you don't do the list, if you don't respond to the list, this is what's going to happen. Dropping down to verse 21, the Lord will make pestilence cling to you until it's consumed you from the land where you enter to possess it. The Lord will smite you with consumption and fever, with inflammation and fiery heat, the sword and blight and mildew, and you shall pursue you till you perish. The heaven which is over your head shall be bronze, the earth which is under you iron. The Lord will make the rain of your land powder and dust. From heaven it shall come down on you until you're destroyed. That's what the prophet's saying. You've just simply ignored the list. Now God's going to do what he had said he had to do. It's just that simple. He's trembling because he sees that God's going to have to do what he said he's going to do. And then he gets real direct. Both prophet and priest are ungodly. Even in my house I have found their evil, declares the Lord. So he's talking about from the inside out. They're ungodly here. And they bring it into his house as a form of worship. Because of that, therefore, in light of that, their way will be like them to slippery paths in the darkness, into which they shall be driven and fall. For I will bring disaster upon them in the year of their punishment, declares the Lord. In the prophets of Samaria, I saw an unsavory thing. They prophesied by Baal, and they led my people Israel astray. So he's building a comparison here. Remember when the kings came, you had Saul was the first king, and then you had David, and then his son Solomon, and then Solomon's son divided the kingdom. They had a civil war, right? He said more taxes, and the people said no thanks, and they divided the kingdom. And at that time, 10 tribes went to the north, named, and we called them Israel, and 2 tribes stayed in the south as Benjamin and Judah, all right? So what the prophet's saying here is, listen, those people up, and he uses Samaria as the term, right? I saw the people up north of Israel, those 10 tribes, I saw them do an unsavory thing. And his way of saying, I saw them do bad stuff. But he's not using the strongest word for bad. He's saying, I saw them do this unsavory thing. They prophesied and led people astray. But, big contrast of here, but the prophets in Jerusalem, the prophets in Judah there, I have seen a horrible thing. They commit adultery. They walk in lies. They strengthen the hand of evildoers so that no one turns from his evil. All of them have become like Sodom and inhabitants of Gomorrah. An absolute abomination. What had happened in the north was terrible. Enough that God had driven them out. They're in captivity. Gone. Syrians took them. What's happened in the south is even worse. And he said, priest and prophet, you're responsible. You are the ones who are supposed to take the list, bring it to the people, work them through it, and get them where they're going, right? Get them in the right place. Therefore, verse 13, says the Lord of hosts concerning the prophets, behold, I will feed them with bitter food and give them poison water to drink. For, there's the causative. Why? For the prophets of Jerusalem, ungodliness has gone out into all the land. What he's really saying is, they gave poison to the people. They lied to the people. They gave out ungodly advice. Constantly do the wrong thing. Or whatever you're doing, it's okay. It doesn't matter. That's what they kept saying. You're going to be fine. you know, sin, don't worry about it. God's good with you. As long as you're in the land, as long as you get to go to temple, you're good. And he's saying, I'm going to give them poison to drink because you've given poison truths to my people. Thus says the Lord of hosts, and this is critical. This is a big takeaway. The Lord of hosts says, do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesied to you, filling you with vain hopes. Listen, folks, there's a lot of voices out there. There is a lot of voices in our world right now, and they are saying, you're all good. You're good, I'm good, we're all good. Just do whatever you like. Just don't step on anybody's toe. Don't make anybody feel uncomfortable, and we're good. Tolerance is the gospel of the day. Except it comes straight from the pit. The gospel of all days is the word of God. And so these prophets are saying vain things. Hey, don't listen. He's saying, don't listen to them. They're telling you lies. Don't listen to them. I have found that I have a rather large capacity in the diet of my mind. Does anybody here scroll through stuff on the internet? How easy is it to keep scrolling and looking and consuming and consuming and consuming, listening to the voices that will willingly lie to you about what is true and right and good? Stop listening to those voices. Stop listening to the thing that it's all going to be good. That's not truth. It's not the truth of Scripture. Don't listen to those who are filling you, giving you more than you can have of these vain hopes. They speak visions of their own minds, not from the mouth of the Lord. They say continually to those who despise the word of the Lord. Notice how now they describe those people who despise the word of the Lord, but are happy to listen to other things. This is what they say to them. This is really interesting. It shall be well with you. That's the message. You're good. And to everyone who stubbornly follows his own heart, they say, no disaster is going to fall on you. Do whatever you want. Sound a little familiar to our day today? Everything's good. We're all fine as long as we don't step on each other's toes. We're good. Have we forgotten the consequence to people who neglect the word of God? Have we forgotten what happens to people who don't come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior? Who are happily living their lives in rejection? Have we forgotten that God said there's a consequence? It's rather permanent, last I checked. And it's rather unpleasant, last I checked. Somehow we're okay with that. Are we? I hope not. Because that's the message of false prophets. You're going to be fine. It's all going to work out just fine in the end. No disaster is coming to you. You're never going to have to pay a penalty. You're never going to be disciplined for your choice of rebelling against God. Straight from the pit, folks. Straight from the pit. And it's funny that these are God's chosen priests and prophets. So I got to add one more piece here. There are some bad preachers out there. There are some bad people out there that will say stupid stuff and try to trick you. What are you going to do about it? Well, simple. You're going to stay in the Word. You're just going to check them out. You're going to make sure that the Word of God says what it says before you just swallow it hook, line, and sinker, right? Or you're just going to shut it off and stop listening to other people and dig into the Word for yourself. If you're in Christ, as we're studying in Sunday school, the Spirit of God has come to take up residence within you. He now indwells you. He will always lead you correctly if you'll follow him. Take advantage of the God of the universe who's living in you. As you read the word, he will lead you to truth, it says. And he never says that it will not be consequences for rejection of the word of God. He doesn't say that. In fact, quite the contrary. In fact, as in Hebrews chapter 12, we talked today, that those of you who are sons and daughters of God, you will be disciplined because he loves you. That's what he says. He wants you to be correct and get in and follow the things that he instructs. And then he goes after him wide open. He says, "For who among them has stood in the counsel of the Lord to hear his word, or has paid attention to his word and listened?" It's a rhetorical question. It's a figure of speech. It's a way of saying, none of them have stood in my counsel. None of them have heard my words and then listened to them. None. "Behold, the storm of the Lord, his wrath has gone forth. A whirling tempest will burst on the head of the wicked. Punishment has been declared." It's gone forth. It's out of the barn. It's gone. I wasn't sure I was going to say this, but I'm going to say it. Punishment for rejecting the Christ is an eternity in the lake of fire. Hell is a real place. Jesus talked about it a lot. It's terrifying. And it scarcely passes our lips anymore. Have we become the voices of "it's all good"? Have we been badgered into a corner of silence that we wouldn't say, "There's a train coming and it's going to run over you"? Do we care so little for people, their souls, their eternity, that we won't say those things? I hope not. Sometimes our ministry will be like the prophet Jeremiah. There's a tough thing coming, folks. It's coming. The storm is gone. It's out, he says. "And the anger of the Lord will not turn back until he has executed and accomplished the intents of his heart." And he makes a little statement here. It's kind of fun. "In the latter days, you're going to understand it clearly." He's going to send them into captivity. He's going to punish them severely. He says, but you're going to get it. It's not going to be pleasant, but it serves its purpose. You're going to get it. This is what I was doing for you, because he cared for them. Then he talks about these prophets, how anxious they are to say the lies. He says, "I didn't even send them." It says, "Yet they ran." Interesting. "I didn't even speak to them, yet they prophesied." He says, "But if they had stood in my counsel, they would have proclaimed my words to my people, and they would have turned from the evil way and from their evil deeds." And then he says, "Am I a God at hand, declares the Lord, and not a God far away?" They had reduced him down to be like one of their little idols that they propped up on the mantle. That if God was right here, I can go out and he doesn't see me when I'm over here. He says, "Am I a God just right here? Or am I not a God everywhere? Can a man hide himself in secret places I can't see him, declares the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, declares the Lord?" And I have to ask myself the question right here. This is the question that I asked myself. I wrote it down. Am I so stupid that I would make God so small that I don't fear him anymore? Would I make him so small that I think he's residing here at little Ebenezer and not outside the doors of this place? Not out in the places where I live and work and have my other being? That's what he's asking him. Have you made me that small? They viewed him so small that is in verse 25, you start to see, it says, "I've heard what the prophets have said who prophesy lies in my name." They say, "I've dreamed and I have dreamed." How long should there be lies in the hearts of the prophets who prophesy lies, who prophesy deceit from their own heart, who think they can make my people forget my name by their dreams that they tell one another, even as their fathers forgot my name for Baal, the false god? Let a prophet who has a dream tell the dream, but let him who has my word speak, who has my word speak my word faithfully. If you have a dream, say your dream. He says, "I don't care, but But let whoever has my word speak it clearly. I want to offer just a word of caution. In days past, I know nobody here would ever do this, but in days past, I've experienced this. Have you ever known somebody who come up and say, you know, the Lord told me something about you? Or the Lord told me something about what you should do or not do? At least some circles, that's a popular thing. The Lord told me. At one point in time, I was just ready to go off to Bible college, and I was had been excommunicated by my church, my Mennonite background. And I was in a little church out in the country somewhere, and I'm getting ready to go off to Bible college, and the pastor of that time didn't want me to leave. He liked me having me around. We got along well, whatever. And so as I was getting ready to leave, and we're planning this thing to go off to Bible college, he's like, Nick, I just need to let you know, the Lord told me you're not supposed to go to Bible college. I'm like, well, he hadn't said a word to me about that. Maybe when he tells me what he's told you, we'll come back and have a conversation. Be careful with saying the Lord told me something to tell you. The Lord's told me what I need to know. We just need to be cautious that we don't end up kind of like these prophets saying things that, well, simply not true. Therefore, I'm against the prophet, he said. Oh, I'm sorry, we missed a piece that was real important. He said, let the prophet who dreams a dream tell the dream, but let him who speaks my word speak my word faithfully. What has straw in common with wheat, declares the Lord? What does wheat and straw have in common? Well, you can eat one of them, right? The other, in their view, would have been chaff and useless. He's comparing the true word of God will feed you. And then he takes it a step further. He says, is not my word like fire, declares the Lord? And I think the implication here, using other passages as well, it has a purifying effect. It has a way of getting rid of the dross of life if the word of God is allowed to do its work. It changes us. It affects us. It helps us to say, oh, maybe I shouldn't do that anymore. Oh, maybe I should change some of this in me. And purer is what the word of God will help us become. And then he says, and he takes it another step. Is not my word like a fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rocks in pieces? Is not the word of God an effective tool to do exactly what it's intended to do? Only if we put it to work. Only if we put it to work. Behold, he says, I'm against the prophets, declares the Lord, who use their tongues and declares the Lord. And behold, I am against those who prophesy lying dreams, who tell them and lead my people astray by their lies and their recklessness. I miss the spot in verse 30. He says, I'm against the prophets who steal my words from one another. They plagiarize. They have to plagiarize their prophecies. I find that quite interesting. It's they couldn't come up enough with a false prophecy that they've got to go through the books like, oh, the Lord told me. And then they find another book and they have to prophesy, plagiarize somebody's other prophecy. I just find that ironic. Goes on to say, listen to this, verse 32. I'm against those who prophesy, declares the Lord, who tells them and lead my people astray by their lies. And it says their recklessness. And that's a unique term in the Hebrew. The idea has not so much that they're just reckless, but they just take it lightly. It doesn't have weight. It doesn't have gravity. It doesn't have seriousness. And it's translated here as reckless. They lead people astray by the lightness in which they handle the word of God. When I did not send them or charge them, so they did not profit this people at all, declares the Lord. They are basically worthless. Now, I'm going to close on this last section, so hang on, because this one is a little bit interesting. When one of this people, a prophet or a priest, asks you, what is the burden of the Lord? That's an interesting statement, and it's a play on words to have the idea. They would ask the question, What is the burden of the Lord? It's a play on words to say, what is the oracle of the Lord? What has God stated? What is, you know, what did God say is what they're saying here. But that they use the analogy, what is the burden of the Lord? It became a popular statement because every time Jeremiah would stand up and talk, he'd punch him in the face, you know? And it became burdensome. They didn't want to hear him anymore. So they would go to the prophet and say, okay, what has the Lord burdened us with today? It became a statement of derision of the Word of God to the point where the Word of God became a burden and it became a mockery. Has the Word of God become a burden to you? Is it a struggle to pick it up? It was to them. He says, so if they ask you, what is the burden of the Lord? This is what you're going to say. You are the burden, and I'm going to cast you off. You're the burden. You've rejected me, and you're going to get it now. That's the thing that's going to happen. As for prophet or priest or one of you people who says the burden of the Lord in a mockery, I mean, of course, I will punish that man and his household. Thus you shall say, everyone to his neighbor and everyone to his brother, what has the Lord answered or what has the Lord spoken? Because it's already been spoken. You just have to ask what is. What's existing? That's all the question you have to ask. But of the burden of the Lord, you shall mention no more. For the burden is every man's own word. And you pervert the words of the living God, the Lord of hosts our God. Everybody says, this is what the Lord says. This is what the Lord says. And they were just making it up. And he was sick of it. You shall say to the prophet, what has the Lord answered you and what has the Lord spoken? But if you say the burden of the Lord, and if I can say it in what, this is Nick's transliteration here. If you say the burden of the Lord one more time, he says, if you say that, when I sent you saying you shall not say the burden of the Lord, therefore I will surely lift you up and cast you away from my presence, and you and the city I gave to you and your father, and I will bring on you everlasting reproach and perpetual shame, which shall not be forgotten. He'd had it. The misuse or the misrepresentation of God and his word is a punishable offense. You can go all the way to the revelation. And even in the end, he says, don't add or remove. The list is complete. What the Father has given his sons and daughters is enough. It's effective. It's true. And anything less will lead you to a place you don't want to go. Anything more is a lie from the pit. It's enough. I pray to God that the word would be true to us and that we would be in it. We would be people of the word. And not be causing to be drifted by our culture that says, don't talk about that stuff. Don't talk about that. Be quiet about this Jesus. Don't be quiet about the God stuff. We don't want to hear any more of that. You can have your way, I have my way. We're all good, right? Be cautious. Be cautious. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the prophet Jeremiah. Thank you that he had a pretty tough gig and he had to say some hard things. And I thank you that he said them. I thank you that he gave us a clear understanding that your word is true and that you value your word and you hold it as precious and unchanging, and we thank you for that. We thank you that through your word, not only were we introduced to the fact that we're sinners, that we were introduced to your son Jesus, that pointed us away to get out of our sin, to come into a relationship with you just simply by faith. We thank you for his sacrificial death at the cross. Thank you for the word that feeds us daily if we would be fed, that leads us from sin, points us to righteousness, helps us to follow well after you. Guard our hearts, Lord. Pray that we would never disgrace you in any way, that we would honor you with our lives in these days. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Nick, for bringing Jeremiah 23 to us today. Let's stand and sing Word of God Speak as we echo the thoughts that Nick just shared and the Word of the Lord. The last thing we need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Let's sing. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet to hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour Godspeed.
My desire that all of us would place ourselves in a place this week where the Word of God would speak to us, that we would encourage one another with the Word, that it would become essential to our lives. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your Word. Thank you for our time of worship together. Thank you for each person here. I pray a special blessing on each of us here. And those who wish they could be here today, I pray that you would be with them in a tender way, Lord, and comfort them if they're feeling distance. Lord, I just petition your presence in our lives, that you would make yourself well known, and that we would put ourselves in a posture of humility, that we would be contrite of spirit, that we would humble ourselves before you, trembling at your word, that you would pay attention to us, Lord. We need you. In Jesus' name, amen.